In today's video, we're going to be having a look at how to set up Sonoff's latest Zigbee dongle in Home Assistant. I'm going to be showing you how to flash new software onto the dongle, as well as a full setup and install of an MQTT broker with Zigbee2mqtt. Check it out. What's going on, guys? I hope you're all doing well. So this is Sonoff's Zigbee 3.0 USB Dongle Plus. They come pre-flashed with the Z-Stack 3.0 coordinator firmware, and you can currently pick them up for just under $11 in the US and about £24 in the UK. There is a planned price increase for this product, but I'm not sure if it will have taken effect by the time this video is live or not, so it might be a little bit more expensive when you're watching this. Straight out of the box, you can just plug this dongle straight into whatever you're running Home Assistant on, and it will be detected and it will work. However, I would highly recommend you update the firmware on it, just to be able to do things like pair more devices to it and have some of the newer software fixes. We're going to start off by flashing some new firmware onto the dongle, and to do this there's a couple of different methods that we can use. The first method involves taking the device apart in order to access the boot button on the main board. This will allow you to enter the bootloader mode. And the second method involves using a Python script. The Python script will allow you to automatically enter the bootloader mode without having to take the device apart. For this tutorial, I'm going to be using a Windows machine, and I'm going to be following that first method of taking the device apart. Now, that might sound like it's a lot of work, but it's really not. It is just a case of taking out two screws, which is very simple to do. And the reason I chose to do this method is just because this was the original method of flashing software onto the dongle, and the newer method of using the Python script came out afterwards. If you are interested in doing the second method of using the Python script, I will be covering that in a future video where I show you how to flash one of these as a repeater so you can use it to extend your Zigbee network. And I'll also have a link to the official Sonoff instructions that show you how to use that Python script. As always, this video will be chaptered, so if there's a particular part that you want to see, then you'll find those timestamps in the description below. So with that said, let's flash this thing. The first thing we're going to need to do is to download the new firmware for our dongle, and we're going to be getting this from Cohen Cantor's GitHub repo. For this video, I'm going to be making use of the latest stable release of the firmware, which at the time of recording this was the 17th of December 2021. If you are after a more up-to-date version, then you can switch the branch over to the developer branch and you can use the more up-to-date developer branch, but it is a developer branch, so do expect some bugs. From here, we're going to choose the top one, which contains that launchpad coordinator. And we're just going to download that. Next up, we're going to need to download a bit of software that we're going to use to flash the firmware that we just got onto our dongle. And to do this, we're going to be using a tool called the Flash Programmer. And again, you'll find a link to this in the description below. On the Flash Programmer page, you're going to just need to scroll down until you see the download. And then you're going to want to choose this, Flash Programmer 2, and then the download options. Now, there is a bit of an annoying caveat to this download where you're going to have to sign up in order to access the download. But once you have done that, you can download and install it. So you should now have the Flash Programmer set up and installed. And what we now need to do is to just tell the Flash Programmer where the firmware is and where our dongle is, and then we can begin the flashing process. But in order for the Flash Programmer to see the firmware, we are going to need to extract it. When you downloaded the dongle firmware, it should have downloaded as a zip file. So all we need to do is to just locate that file and just extract it out. So I've got mine here on the desktop, and all we're going to do is just right click it and choose extract all. We'll then get an extracted folder, and inside of that we'll have a .hex file, which will be the file that we use to pass to our Flash Programmer. And if we jump back to the Flash Programmer, we can now point it at that extracted file. To do this, we're going to choose browse at the top. We then just need to locate our file, and we're going to select it and choose open. Next up, we're going to disassemble the dongle, and it is just a simple case of removing the two screws and then carefully sliding it out of the metal enclosure. I really like the design of this dongle, and although the enclosure looks like a heatsink, it is in fact not one. On the main board, you'll see two buttons, a reset button and a boot button, and it's going to be the boot button that we need to press and hold in order to get us into that bootloader mode. Again, we're following the method where we need to physically take this apart and press and hold that button in order to get it into boot mode. But if you didn't want to do that, there is the option to use the Python script method. But for now, what we need to do is press and hold that button, and as you're holding it down, you're going to want to plug it into your machine. An easy alternative, if you can't physically get this into your machine whilst holding the button, is you could use something like a USB extension cable. But you need to ensure that you're holding that button down before you connect it to your machine. Once it's connected, you want to just press and hold that for roughly 10 seconds, just to ensure that it does go into the bootloader mode. When you connect the dongle to the machine, you should see it appear in the left-hand side as a connected device, and it'll probably come under Silicon Labs USB. Just under that, we need to make sure we select it, and then we need to select a target device for it. So we need to choose CC2652P. If yours doesn't show up as Silicon Labs in the connected devices and you can just see unknown devices for all of them, then more than likely it's a driver issue. If you open up your device manager and have a look under other devices, then you should see a little yellow triangle next to the USB, and this just means that the driver's not installed. A simple way to fix it is to use the Windows Update. So you can just right click on it and choose to update the driver, and then we can search with Windows Updates. If you select this, it should just open up your Windows Updates and prompt you to access that page. I'm using Windows 11 here, and all I need to do is just head into the optional updates, and from within here I can just choose the driver updates and then choose Silicon Labs and click download and install. If you're using Windows 10, then it's a very similar process, and once that's installed you should see that that little yellow triangle's gone and I can now see the Silicon Labs USB. So if we click the refresh on the left hand side, or if you just wait a second, it should just automatically refresh and we can see the Silicon Labs USB just there. If you did add it again through a driver, you're going to want to make sure that the selected target device is set. So again, just check that that's set to CC2652P. Then we just need to check that a couple of other options are ticked and unticked. So you want to make sure in actions that erase is ticked, program is ticked, verify is ticked. And then in the top right, you'll see some image override options, and you want to ensure that the disabled bootloader is unticked. If you do tick it, you can cause yourself a couple of issues, so just ensure that is unticked, and then you can go ahead and click the play button. If you do click that play button and it instantly goes red, then more than likely you're not in the bootloader mode, so you're going to want to just remove your USB and you're going to want to try that process of getting into bootloader again. So just make sure you're holding down that boot button before you plug it into your machine. And when you do plug it into the machine, you're going to want to hold it down for about 10 seconds or so. You can then repeat that process of clicking the play button, and hopefully that goes through. If it does keep going red and failing and you are struggling with this, then I would suggest checking out the Python method. So hopefully you're not struggling and you did manage to get it into the bootloader mode. And when you do hit the play button, you'll hopefully see that a success message, and that lets you know then that you've successfully flashed the dongle. At this point now, that's the new firmware flashed to the dongle. So you can just go ahead and plug this straight into Home Assistant and you're good to go. If you do already know how to set up an MQTT broker, or you already know how to set up Zigbee to MQTT, then you can just skip the rest of this video, or maybe you're not going to use those and you're going to use ZHA, then again, you can also skip the rest of this video. But if you do want to know how to set those things up, then stick around because we're about to run through them. We're going to start off by installing our MQTT broker, and for this, we're going to be making use of Mosquitto. So from our Home Assistant dashboard, we're going to head into configuration. And from here, we're just going to choose add-ons and backups. And in the bottom right corner, we should see the add-on store, so we're going to go ahead and press that. And from here, we can just search through for the Mosquitto broker, or at the top here, there's a handy little search bar. So you can just start typing Mosquitto broker in there and it will start to appear. However, I can just see it here, so I'm just going to choose it here. And we're just going to click install. That should just take a couple of minutes to install, and once that is done, there are a couple of extra bits that we need to do in order to finalize the MQTT broker setup. The first one is a bit of a personal preference really, but I would recommend it, especially as this is going to be your MQTT broker, but it's this option here for the watchdog. So if the MQTT broker crashes, then the watchdog will automatically restart the add-on, which is really what you want with a broker. But this is just personal preference really, you can do whatever options suit you. So I'm going to turn the watchdog on, but I'm going to leave auto update off. The next bit of our broker setup is we need to create a user for the broker to use. Now there's a couple of different ways of doing this. You can just go directly into the configuration and just hard code a user in there, or you can go into the Home Assistant users and create a user that it can use like that. I'm going to use the Home Assistant way just because I don't want to give the account full permissions, and with Home Assistant we can easily control that. So let's head into the configuration here, and we're going to choose people and zones, and up at the top there we want to select users, and from here we're just going to go down to the bottom right corner and we're just going to click add user. That will then just give us this handy form to fill in to create a new user. Now this user is going to be specifically for MQTT, so I'd give it a display name and a username that's going to make sense for that user, just because you'll probably see this name appearing in the logs and you'll want to know what it is. So go ahead and fill that in with some credentials. I've then also gone ahead and ticked this optional can only log in from the local network. This is going to stop this user from being able to log in externally from the network, but as this is MQTT and it's local, this is going to be fine for me. So I'm just going to go ahead and click create. And with that done, we've got our new MQTT user, which is local only, and you'll also notice that we didn't add it as an administrator, so it's got basic user permissions and it's local only. We can now move on to the setup of Zigbee to MQTT. So to do this, we're going to head back into configuration, I'm going to choose Add-ons and Backups again. And from here, we're again going to choose the Add-on Store. Zigbee2mqtt isn't part of the official add-ons or the community add-ons, so we're going to need to manually add this ourselves. To do this, we're going to click the three dots up at the top, and we're going to choose Repositories. And from here, we're going to just need to add the URL for the repository. You can find this in the description below, so go and grab that and just paste it in here. And with that pasted in, you can just click Add, and then Close. You should now be able to see these two Zigbee2mqtt add-ons. We've got the standard one, and we've got the development one. We're going to go ahead and click the standard one. And we're going to click Install. This should also just take a couple of minutes to install, and when it is done, we've got those personal preferences to make again. I'm going to again turn on the watchdog, but I'm also going to choose to turn on the sidebar, just so I can have that easily accessible all the time in the sidebar there. With that done, we can head into the configuration for the add-on. So up at the top, we're going to choose Configuration. And in here, there's going to be a couple of lines that we need to add. So we're just going to add in the user credentials for the user that we created for the MQTT broker. On line 7 there, we can see we've got the MQTT options, and on the line below, we've got the base topic. So just underneath this one, we're going to want to add in our username and password, so let's go ahead and do that now. And that should look a little something like this. So you've got user followed by the username of the account that you just created. In my case, it was MQTT user, and just below that, we've got the password, and again, that's followed by the password that you also created for that account. And once you've done that, that's the user credential side of things all done. The final part of the config for this is to just tell Zigbee2mqtt which port you've got your Zigbee dongle plugged into. So if you haven't already, you're going to want to unplug your dongle from the machine that you were using to flash it and just reassemble it. With that now reassembled, you can go ahead and plug that into your Pi or whatever machine you're currently using to run your Home Assistant on. With plugging in your Zigbee dongle, if you do happen to have a USB extension cable, I would highly recommend using one, as it can help avoid any interference caused by your machine, and it can also help to increase your Zigbee range. Now that we've got that plugged into our Home Assistant, we can figure out what port our dongle's using, and we can use that information to finish the configuration for Zigbee2mqtt. So to do this, we're going to head into Configuration again. And from here, we're going to want to choose Add-ons, Backups and Supervisor. And up at the top, we're going to select System. And from here, just underneath the host card, we're going to click the three dots, and we're going to choose Hardware. From here, we can see a list of different bits of hardware that make up our Home Assistant, and we can just scroll through this list until we find our USB dongle, but a nice and simple way of actually finding the dongle is to just do a search. So by making use of the Flash Programmer, I know that the USB dongle was identifying itself as a Silicon Lab product, so if I just do a search for Silicon, you'll see as I start typing that, it comes up with the USB dongle here. So this is the bit of information that I actually want. So we've got our USB dongle there, and if I just select that, it will tell me all the bits of information I need about it. And the bit of information that we care about is this device path here. And I can see it comes under dev/TTY USB 0. So I'm just going to copy this section here. And now that we've got that bit of information in our clipboard, we're going to head back into configuration. And again, we're going to choose add-ons. And we're going to select our Zigbee2mqtt add-on and head into the configuration. And in here, we're going to want to just update this port with the information that we've got on our clipboard. We're then just going to scroll all the way down and we're going to hit save. And with that now done, that should be all the configuration for our broker and also for Zigbee2mqtt. So what we now need to do is just to kickstart both of them. So we're going to go back into configuration. We're then going to choose add-ons and we're going to select the MQTT broker first. And we're just going to hit start. Once that's started, we're just going to go back and we're going to do the same thing but with Zigbee2mqtt, so we're going to select that, and again we're just going to press start. Your broker and Zigbee2mqtt should now both be running, and there shouldn't be any issues with them. If you check out the log for Zigbee2mqtt, it should just be all green and you shouldn't see any red error messages. Before we start adding any Zigbee devices, there's just one final step we need to do, which is to just enable the MQTT integration. So for the last time, if we head to configuration, and this time we're going to choose Devices and Services, and you should see that it's discovered MQTT, so we're just going to click Configure there, and we're just going to click Submit, and then Finish. And that's literally it. Everything should now be running, and you're now free to just start playing around with Zigbee2mqtt and start adding your own devices in. So let's just add a couple together, and then we'll wrap this up. So I'm just going to select Zigbee2mqtt in my sidebar there. Then up at the top here, we're going to just select this Permit Join All. And that's going to allow Zigbee2mqtt to start discovering Zigbee devices. So I've got one of these Akara buttons to hand, so I'm just going to pop this into pairing mode. So that button's now in pairing mode, and I can see it popping up here. My Akara button's now paired, and if I wanted to, I could rename it here to give it a nicer friendly name. So let's just go ahead and quickly do that. And we're also going to select this update Home Assistant entity switch here and click save changes. So I added that Akara button, and I also went ahead and added one of the Akara wireless switches. Now back here in our integrations, I can see that I've got two devices under the Mosquitto broker. And if I click on those, I can see that it's automatically pulled through that Akara button and also the Akara wireless switch. And there we go, guys. That's been a quick look at how to flash firmware to the Sonoff Zigbee dongle, as well as a quick guide on setting up an MQTT broker and Zigbee to MQTT, all within Home Assistant. If you have enjoyed this video, then don't forget to drop me a like. And if you're not already, hit that subscribe button and ding dong that notification bell. You'll then be alerted to any future video that I do. And as always, a massive thank you to these awesome dudes. These awesome dudes are my Patreons. If you're interested in helping support my channel, which in turn allows me to create content like this, then you'll find a link to my Patreon in the description below. But thank you for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one. Cheers.